Welcome back, and we have Harley Schlanger. I'd like to say the casino called the Obama Princess, that's P-R-I-N-T-S-S, Janet J.P. Yellen, we'll call her J. Print, P-R-I-N-T-S-S, casino in Las Vegas. I'd love to see a sign up that says, closed due to Glass-Steagall. So we want to stick to some basics here. We have a nail in that has to be removed from a board. That nail is called Obama. And we've been talking about this for some time, about impeaching and putting in Glass-Steagall. If we stick to basics rather than all of the other fluff out there that the Republicans now feeling there, as you say on the break, you're their oats, Harley.
Yeah.
If we stick to basics so we can actually get the damn nail out. And I don't believe it's not just a matter of being a puppet, because he is. He's a willing puppet. But this will actually truncate and cut off the head of the snake of the puppeteers, like Father Geppetto, Soros, that's puppeteering Obama and the global bankers. It'll put an end to their schemes, because this is a train to hell, and the only way to stop it is to pull that damn nail out called Obama.
Well, and I think we're at a point where the consequences of not doing it are almost too horrible to contemplate. If you look at the reality of Obamacare, if you look at the reality of the so-called QE, the quantitative easing policy, at the same time there's been an absolute collapse of the real economy. What you see is that this economy is set for a blowout. You can't really put a date on it, but it's like the 2008 bubble. LaRouche warned in July 2007 that the bubble was going to pop. Now, it took about a year from that for it to finally pop. Did that mean he was wrong? No, he said it's a bubble and it's going to pop. Now, we've got a bigger bubble now, because they continued to pile up derivative obligations in the so-called too-big-to-fail banks. We have the stock market hitting record highs every day,
16,
selling stock in companies that haven't made profits in years. So we're seeing a very fragile financial situation, but at the same time, the American people are beginning to realize that they've been swindled.
Right.
And
now
that the swindler, at least the front man for the swindlers, is Barack Obama. And so my advice is that we keep focused on two major points, maybe bring in a third point, of impeachable offenses of Obama. The first one being his bailout policy, which is continuing to protect the too-big-to-fail banks with bailouts and slaps on the wrist when they're caught committing crimes, while he's killing off the population with food stamp cuts, with part-time temporary jobs, and so on. Secondly, Obamacare, which is a policy that's a killer. And third, if you want a third issue, it's his alliance with al-Qaeda, as proven in the Benghazi case and Syria. If we stick to those issues as a bill of impeachment, I think we can get him out in the near future, because the one thing that's held him up to this point, the ironclad support of the Democrats, even Democrats who didn't like him, many of them are now about to jump ship because they see the ship as the Titanic.
Right.
So we can get rid of this guy, but we've got to stay on the subject.
Who's going to actually start the process? Is it going to be, is it going to be a collective of states? Is it going to be senators and congressmen that haven't been doing their job that suddenly decide it's time to do something? It should be bipartisan, because there's a number of Democrats that realize that Obama doesn't give a rat's behind whether they get reelected or not. And they should understand now that this rollout is not going to work.
No, it has to be bipartisan, and it has to be both houses, because in the Republicans in the House of Representatives have the votes to do the impeachment, but the trial to get him out would take place in the Senate, which is currently under Democratic control. Now, I have my problems with some of the Republicans in the House, because I think they'll botch the job if you don't get some Democrats in there. But in the Senate, we're seeing now at least 10 Democrats, maybe as many as 14, who are prepared to tell Obama, who are up for re-election, don't come campaign for me, we're not working with you. Begich from Alaska, who's
not enough,
furious about the Obamacare.
But this isn't enough, though. Trying to just say, don't show up at my election campaign or don't make comments.
Oh, I know that. What I'm pointing out, though, is that the cracks have already appeared. Right. Now the question is, at what point do they decide they have to go from distancing themselves to active opposition to the president?
I think some
of them are nearing that decision point.
I'll tell you when that decision point will strike. It will strike when people realize if the system starts to work, to get enrollees for the healthcare system, and they realize that their premiums are going to double and their deductibles are going to triple. They're going to find
already happening.
But I'm talking about big numbers. This number is just what I call the first wave or the P wave of tsunami. When this system is rolled out and they've, quote, cleaned up the bugs, say, in the next 90 days, and a lot of enrollees realize there's been maybe not 2 or 3 million, but maybe up to 19 or 20 million people that are being deinsured and can't afford to buy insurance. Some of the numbers I've heard are estimating it could go up to as high as 52 million people who could lose their previous insurance. And at least half of those won't be able to purchase insurance. So up to 25 million people could be literally in a position where they can't afford to buy insurance because they lost their previous policy. And then the Republicans and Democrats both have a bill out to say you can keep your insurance, but it's only got a time limit of a year. This doesn't fix the problem. And then not only that.
On this point, it's very important that a very interesting case happened of a woman in Washington State who initially signed up online. Washington had a few people that got through. She signed up online, and she sent an email to Obama thanking him, saying after 15 years of insecurity, she was finally able to afford health insurance thanks to the subsidy. Obama read that email at one of his press conferences about 2 weeks ago. Now, that woman in the last couple of days has come out and said she received subsequently a letter from the insurance company saying she's not qualified to get the subsidy she thought she was going to get, and so she still can't afford health insurance. So this is one case that's going to start turning into a rock slide of people who initially thought they had a deal and then found out it was taken away from them. Because what Obama did by saying he's going to allow people to keep their policies for a year, that's going to bankrupt the insurance industry. So the insurance companies are going to turn on him. And, you know, up to this point, they've worked hand in hand.
Well, in fact, right now, both the Democrats and Republicans are crafting bills that will exactly do that.
Yeah.
In other words, it'll move in a situation where it literally could, with that bill, completely collapse private health insurance, and the only thing left is a public health policy, which doesn't exist yet. There's no public, 100% all American.
And which Obama would never support. And so this is why I'm saying, as you were saying, as this thing continues to develop, if they get the website fixed, it's only going to speed up the process of his impeachment.
Exactly. Exactly.
So
it's almost like
what we've got to do is move aggressively to get him out, to talk to the senators, talk to the members of the House, and tell them, look, how much do you have to see before you realize he lied and lied and lied? You know, the report came out today that Obama knew back 3 months ago about the March report that the website wouldn't be up on October 1st, and he withheld that information. That's another lie.
Well, basically his entire administration has been the most non-transparent lying and twisting the truth. And even when he knows that something's going to come out to counter, he always tries to see the spin master. He should be actually in a Chinese circus where he spins plates on a rod, and he can actually probably handle two plates at one time while looking at a teleprompter and giving you one of his neuro-linguistic NLP speeches he does that are bristling for him. I mean, it's amazing what this guy can do. He is the spin master. And he knows it. He actually knows, hey, here's another wave coming, no problem, I can spin through it. I'm the Teflon president.
That's what happens with a narcissist.
My gosh, we have a terminal case of cyanide narcissism. Cyanide for us is what it means. What I ended up having to do is work for a Florida-based corporation at $60 an hour. No benefits, nothing. Just to get some extra money.
Yep.
Welcome back. And Arlie, we have this gathering storm. In fact, it's interesting that both the Democrats and Republicans are calling for a bill to allow people, including Bill Clinton. Bill is the one who actually dropped the camel's straw, I call it, the straw that broke the camel's back, because although he's a good, smooth politician, he didn't understand the consequences of what he said.
Well, I think he did understand the consequences. I think he's starting to distance Hillary from Obama.
Yeah, well, tell us why.
Well, what we were talking about before the break, you're seeing a shift in the Democratic Party because the Democrats are going back, the ones who are up for re-election. Actually, let me give you two case studies of this. The candidates for Senate for the Democrats in Michigan and Iowa. In Michigan, Levin is retiring, Senator Levin. And in Iowa, Senator Harkin is retiring. Harkin's a real progressive Democrat. Levin's kind of a bum. But the Democrats have held these seats forever. Now, the two Democrats in the House who are sort of anointed to be the nominees for their party for the Senate seat, both voted for the Upton bill, the Republican bill in the House that called for rolling back insurance policy so you can keep your own policy, even though the president threatened to veto it. 39 Democrats voted with the Republicans to pass that bill. But what's important is these two people who are trying to step up to the Senate, who ordinarily are totally with Obama, decided they had to go against Obama if they wanted to have a chance to win the Senate seat. Now, what we're seeing is that Obama thought that he had trumped the Republicans during the government shutdown and the debt ceiling, because most people don't realize that these are not serious issues. They're just phony issues that are designed to have a ridiculous debate while the economy is being destroyed.
Exactly. Like they start closing open monuments and putting up barriers so you get men on wheelchairs with no legs balancing these barriers on their you know, their artificial legs in their wheelchair to try to move them down to Pennsylvania Avenue in front of the White House. This is just an obscenity to aggravate the public to kind of say, now be good public, because this is what I'm going to do to you if you don't behave yourself. So Obama was basically acting like an emperor, and he pissed off a lot of people.
Except
and I think what's going to
the Republicans fell for the trap,
yeah.
And the public blamed the Republicans. So Obama said to the Democrats, don't worry about 2014, we've got it made now. But that was before the rollout of Obamacare. Remember,
right.
The shutdown of the government started in, mid-September.
Right.
And when the government rollout for Obamacare started right after the government shutdown ended, it immediately turned the tide against the Democrats and against Obama.
Yeah.
And so we've had nothing but bad news for Obama. His latest favorable rating has plunged down below 40%. He's almost at the same level that Bush was at this time in his second term.
Now, here's what I predict will happen. Before Christmas, a bill will be passed by the Democrats and Republicans because they're politically now committed. It's almost like you have a missile fired. You can't recall the missile. So both parties now have committed to do this one way or the other, and it'll probably happen before the holidays, which means the stock shares of these insurance companies is going to drop like a rock, because any rater of any of these companies in terms of the value of these healthcare insurance companies is going to say, you're going to go bankrupt providing the promise of this president that now it says you can keep your insurance if you want it. And that means basically, as soon as this missile is out of the missile launching tube from either party or both parties, that Obamacare is dead. And along with Obamacare, so is the presidency of Obama. He's finished.
I think it might take a little bit longer. I don't think it'll happen before the end of this year. But
I think phase one is going to be the...
is Democrats
have to
who used to defend the president, like Bill Clinton, who are now openly critical, who are now moving away. And that's one step. If you remember, I think you're old enough to remember this. 1972, Nixon won in a landslide. much bigger than Obama's victory, a huge right. landslide. But what happened is the erosion of Nixon's credibility as the Watergate story unfolded, and it was unfolded by the media. And what happened is that at a certain point, Republicans saw that in the 74 elections, they were going to get clobbered by the midterm elections by being associated with Nixon. And so some of them went to Nixon in the summer of 74. So remember, that's almost 2 years after the Watergate break-in. It had bubbled for 2 years, and finally Republicans went to him. Howard Baker was one of them, the senator from Tennessee, and said, Dick, for the sake of the country, you should step down. For the sake of the party, you should step down. And for your own sake, you should step down. And 2 days later, Nixon was on a helicopter leaving the White House. Now, is that far-fetched? Well, in the 70s, it was pretty far-fetched that the Republicans would dump Nixon, especially after his landslide victory in November 72. The reason I think it's going to happen is not just Obamacare, but also things like this J.P. Morgan Chase deal, where J.P. Morgan Chase is going to pay a $13 billion fine
right.
to cover what really cost the nation trillions of dollars.
Yeah.
This is another sweetheart deal. It's
yeah,
not
I saw
tough
the picture.
Negotiating by the Department of Justice. I mean, these guys swindled people. The issue here is that J.P. Morgan Chase sold mortgage-backed securities that they knew that were worthless to their clients. And for that, they should be jailed. The fact that they're paying a fine, and right now J.P. Morgan's fines in the last two quarters add up to almost $20 billion, but that's only half of their profit last year.
Yeah.
So for them, that's just a business expense.
Right. In other words, it's a green light not only for J.P. Morgan. I saw a picture in the UT North County Times here in San Diego, and it showed Jamie Dimon. It's like, it's almost like the cat who has a mouse halfway down his esophagus to his stomach. It's like, this guy is just laughing right at our face, saying, yeah, I got away with the heist. The money's in the vault. Another truck's going to another location. We get all the money, and
well,
we can do it again.
Imagine the case of someone who sticks up a Brinks truck and walks away with $1 million and then goes into Eric Holder and says, look, I'll give about half of it back if you don't prosecute me. That's essentially the kind of thing you have happening. Because he's not even giving half of it back. The estimate that I've seen of the profits that J.P. Morgan made over the last, from 2006 to 2011, on their mortgage-backed security operations is somewhere close to $100 billion.
Right.
So giving back $13 billion in fines doesn't even begin to cover the profits they made.
Exactly. Obscene. And this is the kind of government we have? Come on. It's a conspiracy. It's not a theory. One of the Ryan ideas, wasn't it?
Yep.
Yeah, I'm very evil. Okay, Harley, let's go back and analyze some of these deals. We just talked about the chain CPI. Let's go through this. So this is the husband of Janet Yellen. And then, of course, the Paul Ryan policy of a means test on Medicare, which basically means even though you paid into it, they're going to make sure that you take out of your personal savings in your bank account before they allow you to withdraw from the funds, which are not public, but you've paid into them for your health care. This is just obscene. There's no such thing as a means test for money that you've invested in your own health care for future. It's ridiculous.
These are two of the swindles that are supported by Obama. And what I'm saying, just to before I go into the specifics, just to, if people just joined us or if people are still skeptical, between the absolute atrocity of Obamacare and the immoral swindle of the bailout and the bail-in, Obama is becoming the most hated person in the country. So that even liberal Democrats who supported him are walking away. Now, there are two other issues that are going to cause whatever support is left for him in the so-called liberal left progressive Democrats will end. One is this thing called chain CPI, Consumer Price Index. And this is something Obama is saying should be applied to Social Security, because they're saying things like the 1.5% increase in Social Security payments over the last 4 years, supposedly to keep up with inflation, is too much. Now, first of all, real inflation is closer to 10% a year. If you look at the goods that people actually use and the services they pay for, we're having real inflation of double digits. But because the government lies and says, well, they don't include food prices and fuel prices, among others.
Yeah, so, and portion sizes. You'll see you buy a bag of chips or you buy crackers or buy cheese or whatever, and what you have is portion sizes reduced and prices are either the same or they've gone up.
Or a 16-ounce Coca-Cola is now $1.75. So there's huge inflation. But then what they're saying, and this is George Akerlof, who's a Nobel Prize winner, the husband of Janet Yellen. And by the way, Yellen, the new Federal Reserve Chairman, and Obama support Akerlof's proposal for this chain CPI. What he says is that if prices do go up, people change what they buy. Instead of buying steak, they now buy chopped meat. Instead of buying chopped meat, they now buy dog food. But therefore, they adjust so the inflation doesn't affect them. So therefore, it's a tax on the economy to give them a cost of living increase. Now, when you look at the fact that people, Social Security payments, first of all, they paid into the system. Secondly, they're not large payments. But in many cases, that's all people have to live on. And they figure out a lifestyle so they can barely get by. Then prices go up, and you're saying, well, we're not going to give a cost of living escalator because you can just change your eating habits and your living habits. That's one thing that Obama supports and that Janet Yellen supports. Now, the other thing, and this is something the Republicans and the Democrats are negotiating, to cut the cost of Medicare. They're saying that, well, a lot of retirees need Medicare because they don't have any income or they don't have much savings. But they say there are a lot of people, maybe 25-30% of the population, that when they retire still have money. They have retirement funds that haven't been stolen yet. They have homes. They have cash and savings and things of that sort. So what means testing says is that even though Medicare is a program for everyone, if you have, they want to know how much money you have when you retire, what your assets are, where your assets are, how liquid they are. And then they want to set up a board that would make a determination whether you could pay the cost of your surgery or at least something toward it or not, so that Medicare doesn't have to. So this is a tax. Now, if you're really wealthy, it won't hurt you. But if you're in the so-called middle class who just has enough to get by, and then all of a sudden they say, well, maybe you should sell your house before you get the heart bypass to pay for it.
Right.
That's what they're doing. This is criminal. This is going to kill people.
Yeah, I think people need to understand that this is a bipartisan move. This is not just a Democrat Obama move. And that's why behind the scenes, Obama has been meeting for many months now to put forward a lot of the nasty parts of this Obamacare or a version that will replace it once they repeal the Obamacare. And don't be surprised if they try to shove something through that's equally noxious but sneaky to replace Obamacare, which basically not only will not work but can't work, because it's estimated that at least 200,000 doctors will quit as soon as it's implemented, and 800,000 nurses and technicians will quit, which means they'll have less providers to provide the free health care that they can't afford.
Well, and now here's where you get to the real problem. What LaRouche said is that we have Republicans who are stupid because they're playing into this game, but you have Obama who's evil. And Obama works for the most evil grouping of all, the Wall Street, City of London, swindlers and the insurance companies, the banks and financial institutions. The grain cartel, the oil cartel. This is the so-called one-world government. And, you know, again, this is not a conspiracy. This is a fact. Who sets prices? Who sets interest rates? We know now, because of the LIBOR scandal, that a group of about 10 banks fraudulently set interest rates so they could make money. money on their credit default swaps that they sold, that they forced cities to buy in order to sell a bond.
They now, even made money on them collapsing too, didn't they? They even made money on them collapsing, didn't they?
Yeah. And not only that, but they knew they were going to keep interest rates low. And so what they said in selling these credit default swaps is, if the interest rates go up, we'll pay. Your credit default swap means we'll pay the extra money. But if they go down, you have to pay. Wow. And then they rigged the rates, so the rates went down. And this is what happened to the city of Detroit, where $225 million, 15% of the city's annual fund, went straight in to pay off these credit default swaps. At the same time, they cut pensions. That's the kind of immorality and fraud that's been going on.
And now, by the way, these are private pensions that were walled off from being able to be absconded to by a criminal fraud scheme like this. In other words,
well,
it's private
money. These were the pensions of public workers.
Right,
but they're, you're right. They weren't allowed to take the money out, first of all. And secondly, they had to opt out of Social Security to get in these pensions. So when their pension is cut from $20,000 a year to $4,000 a year, they're going to die because they have no other source of income.
Right.
And that's, see, when we're talking about criminal offenses, and you get a lot of people who talk about the banksters, it's not just something that's interesting to talk about. These are people who have concocted schemes that are going to accelerate the death rate at an accelerating rate. And it means that if they're not stopped, people are already dying because of these policies. And Obama is one of their enforcers. Now, what I'm saying is that because people are beginning to realize they're getting cheated and that it's affecting their livelihood and their future, people are willing to start moving in a way they weren't previously. So we can impeach the guy, but there's got to be a companion action with that, which is to break the power of the people who control Obama. And that's what Glass-Steagall does. Glass-Steagall, the separation of commercial banks from investment banks, the writing down of the trillions of dollars of derivative debt, the insistence that commercial banks, if they're going to be protected by the FDIC, cannot speculate with their depositors' money. This will literally break the bank, break the casino you were talking about. Now, once you do that, people don't have to fear Wall Street money or Wall Street retribution. They don't have to fear that they're going to be cut off from the funds for their campaign because they did something that was right. People can start acting right again in politics. But it's going to take a political revolution. It's going to take the average person who's waking up to know what to do so that we can get Obama out and get Glass-Steagall in.
Exactly. The other thing that has to happen, too, is we have to have a bipartisan move. This hasn't, it has to not be just a Democrat or Republican.
That's right.
It has to be Americans deciding they can't do this anymore.
That's right.
Back in a moment. Because water deficiency is going to kill the southwestern United States, which is the most productive area. Welcome back, Harley. Let's continue on the line we were talking about on the break. This needs to be crystallized into a very straightforward plan. One of the things about the we call the lame brain media and the politicians always want to create a dialectic, or it's impossible or difficult to solve. These problems the LaRouche Foundation has called from the beginning, for example, what Obamacare was going to do. What's happening to the economy, and Obamacare is the last 9-inch silver nail driven into the heart of the vampiric system that we have now. This is going to kill the middle class, it'll kill people, and it will dissemble finally the American economy to the point where if it's fully implemented, it will destroy America and it'll never come back. In fact, I think the movie The Hunger Games is a good example of where we're going. We're going to have a destroyed America that'll break up into sub-republics. And I think that Obama will be, functionally, if we don't get rid of him and impeach him, we will be the last president.
Well, we're headed toward a disintegration, and you know, I just want to repeat again what I said at the beginning, which is that this is reality. The reality is, and by the way, on the LaRouchePact.com website, we have the very extraordinary webcast that was done last Friday night by Lyndon LaRouche, in which he used charts and graphs to show how much of our physical production capability we've lost over the last 30 years, how we've destroyed our skilled labor force, which was second to none in the world. And now we're at a point where we have to import machinists from other countries. How we've lost our food supply capability and our agriculture, so that we're becoming now almost a net importer of food. And so he went through all of this, and it's there in black and white in charts and graphs, and it's actually color charts and graphs as well, but it makes the point of how much we've lost. Now, the other point Mr. LaRouche keeps making is that if we don't turn this around, you go to a point of no return where you're going to have mass death. On the other hand, if you turn it around, we still have, because of our Constitution and because of a kind of makeup of our citizens, to the extent that people still believe in economic justice as spelled out by our constitutional traditions, that is, we don't have an oligarchy, we don't accept the idea that some people are better by birth, that we have the capacity not just to turn it around, but to once again make the United States the powerhouse economically that can lift up the rest of the world. And so we're really at a point where there are these two futures, one worse than bleak, the other very promising. But what's at stake here is whether people will make the personal decision to recognize that we're, as a mortal being, you're not going to live forever, but you should leave something better behind. And that should be the mission of every single American, to work for that improvement of the world so that your children and grandchildren will be able to point back with pride and say, my grandfather built that bridge, or my grandfather was involved in a project that got us to the moon again. That's the way we have to change the way we think. And instead of thinking small and being focused only on pride and ego and personal advances, the way Obama does.
Well, we also needed to realize we have galactic and solar and cyclical challenges. We are
exactly
at the convergence of them, of the major and minor ice age cycles, which means at the very minimum we're heading into a minimum ice age of the last 70 years. We have a collapse in food supply in the world caused by that and by things like Fukushima, which is injecting in the high atmosphere xenon, krypton, and other gases such as radioiodine that destroys the ozone layer and causes UV shock to cause killing of the plants. We have the danger of proliferating weapons, which we've done as part of our dialectic game with the former Soviet Union, and it's now coming back to roost because the Saudi Arabians are now lockstep with the Israelis on planning a nuclear attack on Iran, who now has a very advanced weapon system to counter, and they have the poor man's nuke, the fire-prepared Russian weapons. Obama basically doesn't know how to lead. He always, quote, leads from behind. He actually tries to scam his way through every deal to just make sure he's never responsible, and there's always someone willing to fall on their sword. And this situation here, though, he's come out and given enough promises that he's going to be the fall guy. There's nobody there to fall for him this time.
Well, and you see, this is where we have to make the point that as bad a president as Obama is, he's only following orders. There are people who control him who will gladly let him go and try and put someone else in and maybe tinker with their agenda a little bit. But we've got to break the power behind the throne, and that includes the George Soros networks, the Blackstone Capital hedge fund operations, the dozens of those funds that are pure predatory looters. We've got to deal with the 16 to 20 too-big-to-fail banks internationally that mostly should be put through bankruptcy reorganization and a full investigation that should end with most of their leading executives in jail. We're not just doing that for retribution or revenge. We're doing it because we have to clean up the way people think about economics. Most people think about economics from the standpoint of how do I make it? How do I pay my bills? How do I get ahead? And that's the kind of self-centered, greedy mentality that falls for these bubbles. Instead,
we think about
production, producing a better future, producing the physical products and the physical capabilities to expand our production in the future, then we don't have to worry about budget deficits. We don't have to worry about bailouts.
But we also have to realize we have to be on the watch for a rise of a Republican, basically a fascist austerity regime, like
it's just anti-Obama.
Plans.
Yeah,
it's
absolutely
just
right.
Anti-Obama.
That's
in other words,
the bank we have Republicans because they don't have a solution either. They're so many of them are with Ayn Rand, which is this idea of unregulated battle for the survival of the fittest.
Exactly. And for example, Paul Ryan's idea, which fits in this idea of having means tests on Medicare, et cetera, this is not a solution. We need to have more innovative health care that cuts costs. We need to cut the cost of drugs. We need to put nutraceuticals and innovative care on the board. We need to have hospitals without borders, which means you can have a nursing bed in your home instead of in a facility. We need to start integrating families more into the healthcare system. So in Japan, for example, they have a lot lower number of hospital workers, and families come in and bring the meals to the people, and their death rate in hospitals is considerably lower because the families are going to be watching all the parameters. Closer than even our so-called advanced nursing and other systems. So we need to rethink how we take care of our elderly, and we need to also rethink what is health care. What I see happening is there's really no preventive medicine. The current medical system I call pre-morbid disease and death care. It's not health care. We do not have health care right now. We have a scam. And the current system, which has gone about 75 years since World War II, is scamtastic. It is not health care. What I promote in this program is healthcare. My new book, coming out in the next few weeks, called Functional Quantum Medicine, will be the first in a series that will change medicine on this planet forever. It will change it in a scientific way, in a technical way, in a functional way. And as I propose on healthcare, we need to think that life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness means you don't have to have insurance to have healthcare in this country.
It also means that we don't have to have Obama in the White House. We should never have banks that are too big to fail. Since we're about to end, I'd like to give out a number again where people who are serious about acting in the next couple of weeks to get this impeachment process through, dump Obamacare, and get Glass-Steagall through, call me at 800-922-2907. We're in the process of getting out these charts and graphs and also the educational work necessary to give people the confidence that they can stand up to these crooks and thieves. So it's 800-922-2907. And you can go to LaRouchePack.com to look at the charts and graphs we have on the economy.
Exactly. And if people don't understand that this is a religious ceremony, a vast ceremony of murder, of national, what are called genocide. This is a form of economic genocide that Obama is participating in the global bankers. And it is a religious, if you want to call it, ceremony, and it's being walked through, and the people don't recognize they're being played by both the Democrats and Republicans. And in other countries, similar schemes are being played out because they want to create a new financial order, and I call it Earth Inc., run by the bankers, for the bankers, with the global skins of the former nation stretched over the superstructure of the titanium beast that they've
or
now
created. You could just call it Murder Inc.
Murder Inc., yeah, that's a good one. And yeah, it's
genocide or us.
Hey, that's even better. I wonder if they would, what kind of toys and things they would sell at genocide or us.
Yeah.
That'd be, you can make a whole line
of. Talk to you next week.
Amazing. Thank you, Harley. Call that number, 800-922-2907. Back in hour number two, our health and wellness, hour three, Lowell Ponte, the great withdrawal, an amazing discussion coming up. You don't want to miss it. Get your questions into Michelle for the firing line this Friday. Back in a moment.